Step 24 knots, over.
Are you crazy, son of a bitch?
Vast beaches, bare mountains. Cape Verde Islands create their own dramatically beautiful world in the Atlantic, where livestock has to cross the sea and the fish has to cross the mountains. The main thing is to take it easy. That's what they say on the Cape of Longing. A little metropolis with a sea view, Mindelo on the island of São Vicente. This is where transatlantic shipping routes crossed paths and Portuguese discoverers made a stopover. In the 16th century, the islands were besieged by pirates and were a center for the slave trade. That was a long time ago, but the melancholy has remained. Saudade, longing. This music is the soul of Cape Verde.
Saudade, saudade, saudade.
In 12 hours, the ferry to São Nicolau will set sail. The Ribeira, the Paul. Everything has to go. And if they dawdle, they're going to leave too late again. Manuel Oliveira supervises the loading. He is mostly relaxed, but when necessary, he scolds his people.
The ship has a captain. He's in charge. He's the highest authority, of course. I come next. Here on the deck, I am responsible for everything to do with the cargo. And for safety, obviously. If something on the ship isn't right or doesn't comply with the regulations, then they fetch me. I'm the contramestre, the bosun.
Barrels of liquor, high percentage cargo.
That's firewater, 200 liters. The other barrel too, firewater.
Old ferries like the Ribeira de Paul manage the entire goods transport between the islands. But they only sail once a week. Cargo is bursting out of every hatch.
The ship can transport 150 tons. It's a small ship. So what? When things are organized properly in the hold, you can really get a great deal in there.
Keep cool. A couple of these old tubs have sunk in the past because they were hopelessly overloaded.
It also depends on the seas. Yes, they can sometimes be very dangerous. And sometimes a ship just can't take it. That's what happened to the Teresa, a 600-ton freighter. We'd loaded the hold right up to the brim with wood. And then there were 4 to 5 meter high waves. That was the worst journey of my life. And I've survived 7 cyclones.
The Ribeira de Paul may look like a rusty tub, but she is a real old battle horse of the sea and has weathered many a storm. There is no timetable. If all the pallets are on board by midnight, the Ribeira de Paul will set sail on its scheduled journey from island to island. 15 islands, 9 of them inhabited, the Cape Verde Islands off the west coast of Africa. Depending on their location in relation to the northeast trade wind, they are known as Windward or Leeward Islands. Sahel, in the northeast of the archipelago, is the extension of the Sahara into the Atlantic. Today it is a mecca for water sports, an island for beach holidays. The day is young. José Oliveira is getting ready on the jetty at Santa Maria, He is diving for lobsters. His friend Domingos has the boat for this. They only go out together, not too far, always keeping the shore in sight.
Even today, with only a small swell, it's a dangerous business. You never know how it will end. The weather looks good, then it suddenly changes, and there are waves 3-4 meters high.
José knows where to find lobsters, usually. There are strict rules. Only snorkels and wetsuits are allowed when diving for lobsters. No diving tanks. And only locals get a license. The day started so well, but now the current and the wind are causing problems.
Damn, I couldn't get down properly. The current is really strong. The sea has it in for us today. Let's move over there.
This failure brings back bad memories for José. It's always like that. They resurface out of the blue.
It was off Boa Vista. I was in one boat, my brother in the other. I was just down with the lobster hook. They suddenly gave a signal. So I went up. What's wrong? And then they told me there was an accident. One man is dead. As I got nearer, I slowly realized who'd been killed. My brother. A shock that I can't forget.
A new attempt. Here, it's less risky, and the water is only a few meters deep. This time it just has to work. The petrol for the boat is too expensive. But José had not reckoned with the puffer fish under the bank of coral. He will sell it to a posh restaurant. That will make enough to buy rice and beans for a week. Every dive requires energy, and José is no longer a young man. Lobsters, two at once. One in his hand and the other clamped between his legs. Since tourists started to come to Sal demanding crustaceans, lobsters have become rare. José has to be careful. He is only allowed to catch the big ones. Otherwise, he gets into trouble with the fishing inspectors.
Together, they certainly weigh a kilo. That's enough. I can keep these.
Time for a cigarette. Suddenly, it's back to being a good day. He's one of the best in Cabo Verde, he says. He's proud of this man.
Yes, when I was young. I'm old now. When I began, I was 14. Now I'm 58. How time flies.
Each year, they have been catching less. The sea is overfished. It is not only the tourists that are to blame. Fleets of fishing boats from Japan also have their territories here, perfectly legally.
They come with heavy equipment and hunt in our waters. They have equipment that we can only dream about here on Cape Verde. Our government permits it. Sometimes when I stand on the beach at night and look out, I can see them out there, taking our fish.
What small fishermen like José still manage to catch lands up here on the jetty, where the restaurants buy. For José and his colleagues, this is the only way they can do business. the Japanese and the Spaniards make the real big money. They bought the fishing rights decades ago. Fast money for Cape Verde, but for fishermen like Jose, their whole means of existence is now in danger. The old lighthouse has been standing here for centuries, crooked and rusty. But to this day, it still warns ships about the sandbanks near Santa Maria.
Before, there were hardly any hotels. We caught fish and grew vegetables in our gardens. Life was simple. We had no money, but always had enough to eat.
Tarafal on the island of São Nicolau. Here they also live from the sea. Lucia Lopez is late today. She sells fish on the other side of the mountains. But there are only a few leftovers.
That's all I have for you today.
It's not enough. She needs more. Lucia is tired.
Here, buy my rosefish, 200 escudos for a kilo of rosefish. If you sell it for 250, then you'll have made 50 profit. Come on, I'll put it on the scales.
Lucia invests 500 escudos today, almost 5 euros.
I'll sell it in the village where I live. It's a long way away. I have to walk over the mountain.
She carries up 10 kilos like this on her head. A bit of grumbling helps.
Life is just one sacrifice. You walk and walk and it's almost endless. It's torture. Life is a torture. I have to tighten my belt, slave away to buy half a kilo, to buy a school uniform for the child. I'm working myself to death. What a hard life. What a huge sacrifice.
She won't leave until tomorrow. Then she has to cross this mountain, on foot, with the fish. It's too late today. At home, her daughter and son-in-law are waiting with their child.
Have you eaten already?
No.
Have you cooked yet? Did you leave something for me? I'm dying of hunger. It was a long way here from the market.
The fish is kept in the freezer overnight. It is Lucia's capital. Too precious to eat herself.
So, no lunch. A fried corn on the cob, that's it.
And then wash it down with a cup of coffee, eh? São Nicolau, so deserted on the margins of civilization and time. In Cape Verde, there is a saying, here the goats eat stones. Hidden away in one of the narrow valleys on the island is one of the numerous rock distilleries. Not all of them have a license. Tomás Gómez does. His business is a top-class distillery, well known all over Cape Verde. You need a lot of sugarcane to make good grog. Today, Tomás really has to squeeze out every drop. The The mash has to ferment for 4 to 5 days before it can be distilled into grog, the national drink. Fine for getting nicely drunk, but sometimes fatal.
No, not with my stuff. A liter of this fine grog here costs 10 euros a bottle. The other one from Santo Antão is real gut rot. They sell it for 2 euros, and that's for a big bottle. And if you're unlucky, then you've had it. People fall over, bash their heads, and die. This never happens with our grog from São Nicolau.
Customers come from the furthest corners on the island. They often take more than 2 liters. A sailor on shore leave. Aureliano's ship is docked in the harbour, so he takes the opportunity to organise some new supplies. Grog, the cure-all in the daily fight for existence. Medicine to combat sadness.
Come on, down the hatch.
Connoisseurs know good grog does not produce any bubbles when poured.
Sipping from the spoon is an age-old method of checking the quality, tried and tested. The earlier I get up, the more I drink. In the evening, I also have about 3, 4, 5 of these here, so that I can sleep better. And always in the morning before going to work.
Tomás knows his regulars. He won't be getting rid of Aureliano in a hurry. Buying grog is a matter of trust, he says, and Tomás is the master of the sugar press.
Sometimes I can't keep up with all the supplies. Or the harvest is bad when there hasn't been enough rain. Sugarcane is thirsty. This year the harvest was good. That means plenty of grog. The people come with big bottles and stock up for a whole year to be on the safe side.
Aureliano doesn't want to take any risk either. To fill up the second bottle, he has to go down to the heart of the distillery plant, where water and alcohol are separated, using tried and tested technology, and where you can get drunk on the fumes. He had actually hoped to be home a long time ago. Quality control, the second one. To be doubly sure. Put your hand on your heart, sailor. Do they drink on board ship too?
Of course, all seamen drink. The fishermen while fishing, the captain on the bridge, and the crew, definitely.
And all the ships that sank over the past years?
No, out of the question. They had nothing to do with grog. I would say they were due to the crew's inattentiveness. Maybe they were asleep. Yes, they may have had a drop of grog. Anything's possible. A dry fog can be fatal. You can get off course. Or was it the grog? Who knows? Maybe. Sailors are simply unpredictable.
Evening is approaching in Mindelo on São Vicente. On the Ribeiro de Paul, the loading limit has almost been reached.
Wait, no problem. Make some space there.
Helmsman and captain are relaxed. And Manuel plays the tough guy.
I'm made of iron. I need a lot of coffee, cigarettes, and a shot of alcohol for my circulation. Mine is pretty low.
Shortly before midnight, the passengers go on board. For most of them, the ferry is the only possibility to travel between the islands. They cannot afford the plane. Sometimes there is a delay of a few hours. The cargo has priority. Manuel now has a bit of time for himself, for poetry. The bosun is also a poet.
The sight of the calm blue sea is a picture that can never be extinguished inside me. It's like making love to a woman. It's the greatest feeling. And the worst is when the sea goes crazy, when no one speaks anymore, eats or sleeps, and everyone is saying a quick prayer. Lord, let it be morning.
12:30, release the ropes.
I feel as if I need to sleep for at least 8 hours, but that's impossible. Usually I manage 2 at the most.
Ten hours to São Nicolau. Today no prayers are necessary. The Ribeira de Paúl has experienced some quite different seas in the past on the choppy waters between the islands. Seven o'clock. On the horizon, São Nicolau. No problem. In the galley, breakfast is ready for the crew. Manuel did indeed manage to get a bit of sleep, but even he, the man of iron, is feeling a bit shaky on his legs.
Of course, the ship is overloaded. And then we had a countercurrent near Santa Lucia. We were traveling full steam ahead. But the current was strong, and we slowed down. But still, it was a good journey.
And it's not over yet. São Nicolau, the first stop on the long journey to Sao. The Pedra Luma salt works on the island of Sal, in a volcanic crater below sea level. Salt water from the sea seeps in through porous rock and evaporates. Salt production for export has long since ceased on Cape Verde. Bernhardin Baroche worked in the salt production for almost 6 decades. Now he sometimes visits his brother in the salt works. He's 20 years younger and one of the few still needed to supply the island with salt. The situation with the salt isn't getting any better.
I started at 14. I first worked for 11 years in the carpentry workshop. Then later, from 1956 to 1996, I work in the salt production. This is where the baskets with the salt used to arrive. First it went through a sieve, then onto the scales and finally onto the conveyor belt, down to the sea and the ships.
The cable car was more than a kilometer long, a sensation at that time. All that is left are rotting beams. The salt works of 1805. Wellness fans seeking rest and relaxation have discovered Pedraluma as a new holiday destination and float about in the brine, like in the Dead Sea. Bernardine fears it might all go wrong.
There's too much water inside now that the salt extraction has stopped. This water will mix with the salt and then everything will collapse. Just wait a few more years.
Bernardim has a visit from his son and his son. This helps to pass the time a little quicker.
Oh, I get melancholy when I see this place today. It used to be full of life. There were people here, shops, restaurants, a church, a pharmacy. And now?
It's good that he's not alone. Hardly likely as the father of 18 children.
We never had any telenovelas, TV soap like today. There was no radio, no television, no diversion at all. So we went for walks. We had our fun. What can I say? I didn't have just one wife. That's how life was. I have 18 children, 56 grandchildren, and 25 great-grandchildren.
A last message for the emigrants whom poverty drove across the sea into exile. Boa viagem. Have a good trip. He is working for the future of the Cape Verde Islands. Nuno Vieira, marine biologist at the Cape Verde Fishery Institute. Today he wants to take some water samples in the Bay of Mindelo. Marine research is focusing on the Cape Verde Islands. The Islandia used to be a fishing trawler off the coast of Iceland before the Cape Verde government converted it into a research ship. The crew and the young scientists know each other from many trips together.
In this tropical ocean zone off Cape Verde, we can monitor the changes in the global sea climate very well. And once we understand how the fish react to these changes, then in the long term, we can give our fishermen reliable indications of where there are still good fishing areas.
Shall I stop here?
Yes, it doesn't look bad, 100 meters water depth. This here is a deep sea probe that measures the water density, salt content and temperature. It also brings water samples up to the surface.
From now on, the focus will be on oxygen minimum zones, trace metals, over-fertilization and currents. Meter by meter, layer by layer, the probe will be lowered into the deep. Nuno can follow the operation in his cabin in real time. The computer shows him the results measured by the sensors.
I have contact with the probe. The different hydrographic data appear here. Hydrogen, that looks good. Oxygen. And the temperature, 21 degrees, in a depth of 28 meters. That's a bit too cold.
Where does the water come from? Where is it flowing to? Nuno's readings help researchers worldwide to assess the condition of the sea and climate changes. Now he just has to take out the probes. Later in Mindelo, he will examine them in more detail. The ship helps to do the groundwork.
It's a very good ship, although it's pretty unstable and rolls a lot. Sooner or later, everyone has to hang over the railing. But at least I don't need to shake my water samples myself. The Islandia is my cocktail shaker.
The trips with the Islandia are part of a cooperation between the Cape Verde Islands and the Kielgeoma Institute for Marine Research, an international mission. Nuno is proud to be a part of it.
Cape Verde is poor, a third world country where young people have very few prospects. But I have this unique chance to help my country and to show what we can achieve, even in a poor country like ours. How science can improve our lives.
Seven 7:00 in the morning on São Nicolau. Lucia is setting off. The fish was in the freezer overnight, and now it has to get to the customers quickly. She hitchhikes for the first leg of her journey. Someone always gives her a lift. Lucia, the fisherwoman who crosses mountains. On her head, she carries mackerel, perch, and cod. On her feet, she wears flip-flops. It takes 2 hours just to climb up the stony mountainside. 3 times a week, Lucia struggles up the mountain with the fish.
I need water. I have to rest for a while.
She's heading for the village of Covada on the other side.
I sell fish there as a gesture of friendship because it's my home village. I don't earn much from it. I don't bring any expensive fish that would make me any real money. When I was 22, I left for Tarrafal. Now I'm 40, but I have to carry on. I need strength. I have 2 children and they have no father. He died young, and I have to sell fish so that they have something to eat. With what I earn today, I can maybe buy a kilo of rice for my family. I'll soon be at the top, and then you can see Covada. It's lovely and green there, and the air is wonderfully fresh.
Finally, down there is the village.
Buy fresh fish. Here come fresh mackerel. We don't have any roads for cars, so we have to walk. What a grind. My God, how exhausting. What a sacrifice. Hello, Godfather. How are you?
Just a few more meters. What has Lucia got?
Two mackerel and a needlefish. You have to buy both. I have to see if I can change that. That makes 100 escudos.
Covada, the village cut off from the world, can provide its own meat and vegetables. The fish comes across the mountain.
Don't you want to buy a few perch? And three needlefish, only 100 escudos.
Here and there she has a chat over the garden wall.
Later, I'm first going to buy matches. I can't even light a candle anymore. I hid the best one. It's for my mother, for her lunch.
Lucia's mother has lived up here since she was a child. Now she is old and sick.
How are you today, Mama? Here, Mama, a lovely fish for your favorite stew. For a lovely fish soup, Mama, with potatoes, cassava and green bananas.
She doesn't like potatoes, obviously.
My daughter comes every day. My daughter. What's your name again? Exactly. Lucia from Tarrafal.
Tarrafal in the morning. The Ribera de Paul is still docked at the quay. Training starts on the sports center's artificial turf at 8 o'clock. The boys kick the balls and dream their own dreams for the future. The same ones their trainer had as a boy. Francisco Spencer made it. He was a professional footballer in Portugal. Back in Tarrafal, he encourages his boys in their daily life.
We want to get the boys off the streets. School doesn't start until the afternoon. Without this, they would just hang about and get up to no good. They all dream about a career in football. But I don't want to turn them into football pros with my football school. I want to teach them team spirit.
Of course, they want to become football pros, and famous, and rich. The football project is sponsored by the local fish canning factory. The trainer, Francisco Spencer, has just taken it over from his father, Joaquim. As king of the tuna fish, he is an important figure on the island, the red gold tin with tuna fish from Tarrafal, certainly the best known product from Cape Verde.
I eat a little tuna fish, but it's not exactly my favorite food. Probably I just spent too many years dealing with tuna fish. Every day, tuna fish. My wife is always making me tuna fish with rice. She might as well stop, because I don't eat it anyway. I, on the other hand, am crazy about tuna fish, with potatoes. I've always loved it, even when I was playing in Portugal. I always had tuna fish with me. Or they sent me the red tins. Even today, I still have tuna three times a week. I just don't know how you're going to stand it until you're 80 like me.
In former times, the factory used to be the largest employer on the island. Now, except in the tuna fish season, not one single fish is processed here.
The competition from the Japanese and the Spaniards is overwhelming. And if they all just keep taking them out of the sea, and the fish don't even grow big enough to reproduce, then it's clear how it's going to end, with nothing.
But to just give up? Now it's the turn of the tuna fish king's son, so that the factory does not just become a museum. An office with a view of the harbor. He stands up here to watch when Francisco moves the training onto the lava beach. These boys won't be working in the fish canning factory anymore. Father and son know that. But Francisco hopes that some of his team will have an international career. There is certainly some talent here.
Luckily, we have a FIFA agent here in the town, an ex-colleague of mine from the time when I played on São Vicente. He's already taken a few of our boys abroad, and of course, they all dream about that. That one day, someone will turn up on our dusty beach and discover them.
Atenção, é, bolas vindo lá de cima. Ó, Paulo. Paulo. Bola de cima fora.
The Ribeira de Paul at the quay. There is still some space for cargo. The tuna fish for the hotels on Sal is missing. And the livestock still has to go on board. Manuel, the bosun, always has the situation in hand. And also has an eye for the small inspirations of daily life.
My next poem will not be a normal love poem. It has to be one, how shall I put it, that doesn't even have anything to do with me, but with a totally different person. I don't know her name yet, but I will be thinking of her all week.
And it's off to sea again. The poem will certainly come to him. To Manuel, the bosun, on his journey from island to island, windward and leeward.
Thank you.